A very good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have no apologies this morning and Katie Clark will be joining us shortly. So our first item of business this morning is to continue our pre-budget scrutiny of the Scottish Government's 2024-25 budget. And I'm pleased to welcome the following witnesses, Ms. Theresa Medhurst, Chief Executive, and Mr. Gerry O'Donnell, Interim Director of Finance with the Scottish Prison Service. For their written submission. So we have around about 60 minutes for this session, and I'd like to begin, if I may, with a general question. So can I ask you to outline for us the main challenges for spending in relation to prisons in this financial year and your view on the budgets you think you will need for 2024 to 2025? And I'll come to Ms. Medhurst first.
Good morning, convener, committee members, and thank you very much for the opportunity to come and answer questions on the budget for the SPS. So, in relation to your first question, I think our submission gave some high-level pressures that we are experiencing as an organisation, which have probably compounded over the course of this year. In particular, the population pressures this year, this calendar year alone, we have seen an increase in our population that would equate to somewhere like the size of Perth Prison, so around about 700, and we did tip over 8,000 Monday night into Tuesday of this week. In addition to that, we are a 24/7 operation, so we operate with that population and a staff group of about 4,500 every day of the year. So there are a number of contracts and operations which we require to deliver and services that we require to deliver to that increasing population. So we have experienced significant inflationary pressures right across the budget that we have. And that's also put additional strain on service delivery because of the increased population pressures and the complexity. I should probably stress that at this point, it's not just about numbers. We did experience high population around about 2018-19. The difference now is the complexity of that population, and that complexity comes with it added costs. So things like increased costs for social care. We have increased need to keep people separate, to keep them safe because of the different population types. So all of this comes with cost pressures and infrastructure pressures. In addition to that, we obviously have major capital projects. And we concluded HMP Stirling, which opened this year, although there is phase two of HMP Stirling still to be finalised, which is the demolishing Corton Vale prison, and the new builds for Highland and Glasgow, which replace Inverness and Barlinnie. And again, the construction industry has experienced significant pressures around not just workforce, but also supply chains and additional costs around their supply, not just the supply chain, but their infrastructure costs as well. So across a number of different areas, we are experiencing and have experienced significant pressure this year, and that has led to some challenges around our budget and our ability to live within our budget for this year. Obviously, we are unclear yet what the budget is likely to be for next year. Part of the challenge for us will be in where the population is likely to rise or fall at the moment. And we have been engaged with Scottish Government Justice Analytical Services for the whole of this period to better understand what the drivers are around the population increase, but it's really difficult for them to predict at the moment what we can anticipate, and therefore difficult for us to plan for next year in terms of budget pressures and service delivery.
Just before I bring in Gerry O'Donnell, just on the prison population issue. Now, I know that it is complex and there are multiple factors that impact on the population. Do you think that there is still an element of the population that, or that pressure, that derives from the COVID pandemic that will ease in time? Or is it not that simple?
That's certainly what we, with the increase in court business and there was funding sourced to increase the capacity both for summary and now for solemn cases, we did anticipate that the increase in sentence population should see a decrease in the remand population. So whilst we are experiencing an increase in both short and long-term populations within prisons, we are not seeing any kind of reduction in the remand population. So prior to COVID, the remand proportion of the remand population would have been round about 15 to 17% of our overall population. It's still sitting worryingly high at round about the 27% mark.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I'll bring in Mr O'Donnell.
Good morning, Convener and Committee members. Last year we received an uplift in our budget of £29 million. However, also last year at the spring budget revision, we required an additional £14.5 million of additional in-year funding so that we could meet, have a balanced budget for last year. So in real terms, the increase is actually around £14.5 million this year, which equates to about 3.4% of an uplift. It is a challenging situation like last year because we find ourselves with a number of cost pressures. And Teresa's highlighted about the prison population, which is arguably a new cost pressure this year because the increase has kind of started from the beginning of this year. And to date, we're now over 8,000 people in our care. We also have challenges around private sector contract inflation. One of our main contracts is with HNP Adewale is based on RPI plus 1%, and the RPI at September was at 6.9%. So you can imagine the impact that that's having when your budget increases 3.4%. We also have pay settlement increases that are above public sector pay policy, and in this year we've got the added pressure with the Women's National Facility coming online, which has created additional staff costs this year. We have continued high inflation in areas, utilities, but particularly food costs. We've seen a kind of dramatic rise in food costs in the last kind of 2 years. It's actually around, not only with the population increase, the impact of that, but with food prices, we're looking at overall a 40% increase over 2 years. And other areas, there's backlog inflation. We've got renewal of maintenance contracts that are coming through, and we're seeing price increases again this year. So I think my concern for going into next year is that we need a settlement that is going to deal with these in-year cost pressures, but also adequately fund these increases for next year as well.
Yeah, thanks very much indeed. Okay, so I'm going to open it up to members now, and if anybody would like to come in. Sharon Downey.
Thank you. Could I just go to the Kilmarnock prison transfer? In your statement, you've got Kilmarnock transfer into public ownership is one of the key pressure areas. So it says a full assessment of any likely budgetary requirements for the transfer of the asset into public ownership is currently underway. Has that been completed, because it's due to transfer in 4 months?
That hasn't been completed, but it is well underway. There are differences in the operating models between SPS and Kilmarnock. We are almost completed the work to better understand the implications of those changes in the models and how that can be recalibrated for Kilmarnock, because they have a one-tier prison officer or prison custodial operative, one-tier prison custodial officer cadre, whilst we have two tiers within our prison officer grouping. So there are things that we had to work through to better understand what the implications would be. And as I say, we're almost at the point of finalising that, but not quite yet. And therefore, we can cost that once that has been complete. Appreciate that the transfer takes place on the 17th of March next year. But there is a year during which we will recalibrate or harmonise the position with regards to staffing and other elements of their operation in order to fully bring it into SPS ownership or operation.
It's obviously going to have an impact into this year's budget as well, so should that cost analysis not have been done already?
It will only partially be, because it's the 17th of March, obviously there will only be minor adjustments made in year, and there was an outline cost provided for that, but it's only for a couple of weeks. Therefore, the more detailed work will have to be factored into next year's budget, and that will be done in time to feed that into the budget round for next year.
But is there no big impact in this year's budget because actually transferring it from Serco into SPS?
I'm not sure if I understand the question because clearly the contract is still operational as it currently stands, whilst we have additional costs factored in to pay for the project team that are developing the transitional arrangements. In actual fact, it's still running as a private sector contract at the moment. So I'm not sure where you are seeing that there would be additional costs this year.
Please, if I can come in. Mm-hmm. We do have, in this year's budget, a transformation budget. It's approximately about £1.4 million. And that budget is for the team working on the transfer of the project. Mm-hmm. And there is taken into account the element of the last week of this financial year. So it's fully costed this year in terms of our position.
So it's £1.4 million just to transfer it from Serco to SPS?
That's
to establish costs to ensure that we have fully developed the arrangements under which the private sector contract will cease and it moves into public sector operation. It is quite a complex arrangement because it's not just about the transfer of people, which obviously comes with a range of sensitivities, but there are systems and processes that are Serco's and Serco-owned that either we then have to retain or we have to put in place our own systems and processes. So all of that has had to be factored in, and that has taken the best part of the last 2 years, I think. So we've been planning for this for about 2 years.
There's work being done on digital transformation, and even buying uniforms, for the transfer. So there's a whole range of items. It's a small team that's been working on the project, but there's always the staff costs of that team as well. It is in that £1.4 million.
And that's the kind of cost that I was talking about, because obviously there will be like basic things like uniforms, but there's also going to be procurement things as well. You're talking about the change in price and food that's went up 40%, but obviously I would imagine that all the contracts that Serco have are going to stop on the 16th and you're going to have new contracts on the 17th. So I would have thought that you would maybe have had a better idea of what impact that's going to have in the budget, given it's happening in 4 months.
I think some of these contracts will be kind of almost like novated across. I think as an organisation, we're going through the budget process just now. Now, all the kind of costs of running Kilmarnock are not in Kilmarnock. There's an impact across the organisation and estates costs and, other support service costs that probably were provided by Serco's head office in supporting Kilmarnock. These costs are now part of our budget. So we're going through that budget process and we'll have a clearer idea in the future of the exact budget that's required for running Kilmarnock as an operational establishment next year.
So as taking Kilmarnock back into the public sector, is that best value for money for the public purse? Have you taken any best practices that are currently at Kilmarnock and to look at maybe implementing them into the SPS system, because I've heard kind of figures of it could cost 3 to 5 million. I don't know if you can tell me a better figure, but I've heard that ongoing costs, and not including the 1.4 million just for the transfer from Serco to SPS, I've heard it could cost 3 to 5 million extra additional costs to run the prison SPS rather than Serco. So have you taken any best practice learnings from Serco?
So I think there are two elements to your question there. And the first one is around costs. Now, the contract for Kilmarnock was originally set, I think, in 1997, and the prison started operating in 1999, and it's a 25-year contract. So the pricing mechanism and the arrangements, I think that was one of the first private sector contracts within Scotland, would be markedly different today with today's cost pressures than it would have been in 1997 and 1999 when the contract was originally let. What I can say to you is that with regards to Addiewell, which is about 14 years old, the price for Addiewell is higher than it is for Kilmarnock, and it is higher than for public sector prisons as well. And whilst there aren't any other direct comparators within Scotland, Kilmarnock is cheaper than the private sector contracts down in England and Wales. But as I say, there is an iterative process of changes of contracts and updating of contracts. And so I don't know what the cost would be nowadays, but it certainly would be more expensive than it was, or the current running costs would be. And we would anticipate that the costs would be much much higher and more significant. With regards to the second part of your question about best practice, I'm really keen to explore learning that we can take from Kilmarnock, because there are a number of ways that they operate that are quite different than being the public sector, private sector. So the team are working really hard to identify areas of best practice that we not only explore when we take on the operation of the prison next year, but we look to explore whether or not that's something that we can extract and share across the whole of the prison estate.
If I could come in and give a good example. So the custodial management system that's operated at Kilmarnock, so we've decided that we're going to keep that system, and that allows those living at Kilmarnock to order their meals online, book their visits, and also canteen. So that's an innovation that we're keeping. And as part of our own telephony in cell project, that's something that we're wanting to develop as well. So we are keeping some aspects of best practice.
Thank you. Just one quick.
I'm going to have to move on. I'm sorry, I've got a number of members wanting to come in. So I'm going to bring in Pauline McNeill and then Fulton McGregor.
Thank you. Good morning. Just on that line of questioning that Sharon Dowie undertook, you'd said that the Kilmarnock staffing structure had one tier, whereas SPS had two, and I was aware of that. I think it was one of the reasons that Kilmarnock was able to say that they ran it cheaper than SPS because they didn't have the same grading structure. Does that mean that the figures that you've been outlining, that those figures are incorporated into that if you go to a two-tier structure? Presumably it's a lower pay, higher pay structure.
So the financial envelope that we anticipate we will require for the operation of Kilmarnock will include that information. And that's why I said to Ms Dowie that we are in the final stages of developing that, because it will need to take account. They also have operational support group who have no prisoner contact. With our staff, anybody who's operational will have prisoner contact. So there are some quite distinct differences that we've had to work through and ensure that the operating model reflects best practice, but also is as cost effective as it can be.
So will they just wait to hear when that work's done?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. I wanted to ask you about recent press reports about Berlin Prison in Glasgow. I think you've already alluded to that, that there are issues with construction, the construction industry. Could you elaborate a bit more? Has the timetable changed again? And what are the actual reasons that you're being given for the delay? I mean, I understand that the costs are going up for raw materials, but that's a case across the sector. It just seems, given we're building one prison here and it is a priority, I'm really having difficulty understanding what seems to be repeated delays in the bringing about of this new prison.
Okay, I mean, in Glasgow, I think when we talk about delays, I mean, I think our original kind of timetable back, I think it was September 22, had a date, but that, was very much an estimate. And in terms of Glasgow, I wouldn't say that there's been kind of real significant delays. One of the challenges we had this year was that our capital budget at 97 million meant that we could only undertake a certain amount of kind of advanced works. Now, at Glasgow, we are still in discussions and finalising a design, and then a price with the contractor. Now, then it's anticipated that we will do that in the next 12 months. We originally, going back to that original date, was based on the fact is that by this month we would have a design for large parts of the prison, but we would have areas that hadn't been fully designed. Now, what we've done is taken the decision that we are now going to finalise the whole design by April this year. So while I don't think there's really been any delays in the design in terms of HMP Glasgow, yes, there has been that we haven't done the amount of advance works that we'd anticipated, and therefore that will probably have some impact on the programme. But I wouldn't say it's going to have a significant impact on the programme.
Right, but would you agree that there's an urgency to get a replacement for Bellini Prison?
Absolutely, yes.
So to a layperson, I don't understand why there could be such a delay in the design of a prison. I mean, we built prisons before. I mean, what is there a requirement to build something different here? I mean, why would it take to April to finalise the design before you even put something in the ground?
Uh-huh. Sorry, I mean, it's, again, the approach that we've taken with HMP Glasgow is that we've had early contractor engagement. Now, a traditional approach is you would go off to get an architect, designer, to build you design you a building, and then you would engage a contractor, and you would then create that kind of vision into a kind of construction design.
It's a lot slower.
No, I think it's the opposite. I think we're actually on track for our design, because the things that we anticipated to the design by this month, we have achieved that. But what we're now doing is we're designing the whole facility. And engagement with the contractor was July last year, I think it was the date. So it does seem, a year and a half. However, it's a significant project, and I think many other projects you'll find have had longer design periods from inception. So
there's maybe not the same urgency in other projects. Mm-hmm. Here, as we've discussed many times, it's absolutely a human rights disgrace what prisoners are putting up with. And obviously, I'm passionate about this because I'm a Glasgow MSP, so I say that openly. I'm horrified that in West Central Scotland that we've got people set on remand sent to this prison. And I don't even fully understand all the complexities of this. But I'm deeply concerned what seems to be taking an eternity to build a prison. And we've built loads of prisons before. I really cannot understand what you're saying to the committee. Is there something special about this design, or
can I come in?
Really struggling.
So, I understand what you're saying about the design. I equally understand what you're saying about the concerns around Bellini. I obviously carry the responsibility and the risk should there be any infrastructure failures in what is an aged and pretty poor conditions that people are living in, and the infrastructure that exists, does become ever more fragile each year that it operates. So I understand completely those concerns and would be delighted if we could deliver Glasgow in a much shorter timescale.
So why not? So I really do genuinely do not understand what the problem is. So the design's not going to be available till April. What does that actually mean in practical terms? When you get the design, does that mean you can go ahead and actually build it? And how long does that take, roughly?
So the design, whilst we have built prisons in the past, we haven't built prisons of this size. So this is the biggest prison that we've built. The teams have looked very carefully at recent designs in other jurisdictions, and we obviously needed to include learning and best practice from COVID. We understand the requirement to operate a prison in a much more discreet way with smaller populations. Berlinney, as you know, has got 300 to 400 in a hall, and they come up and down the stairs to collect meals and back up again. So having much more discreet communities of around 20 individuals will feel much safer and will produce much improved support arrangements for individuals on their rehabilitative journey whilst in custody. I think the other thing as well, though, is that we need to design in features that are compatible with net zero, and all of that does take time to do. But certainly the team are not, I can please assure you that the team are not sitting on their laurels, and we are all committed 100% to getting this through as quickly as possible, Ms McNeill.
I don't doubt that. I really don't doubt it. I'm just trying to understand it. And so what is it, 2026? You feel that the completion date...
Can I maybe... I know you're very passionate about this, but if you can maybe just...
I'm only reiterating what I already asked you, which is, I know, can you give us a rough indication of the year?
Can't remember the last date exactly. I'd need to come back to that. Ms McNeill, let me do that.
Okay. Wonderful, and I'm happy for Ms Medhurst to follow up anything in writing that you're seeking answers to. Okay, thank you. Fulton MacGregor and then Russell Finlay.
Hey, thanks, Cameron. Good morning to both of you. I wanted to ask about the through care services, and obviously this is an issue that's came to committee before, and I know that there's been various exchanges on it. I suppose I could just start, Teresa, generally, what is the update of the current position on through care services? I might have missed it, so forgive me if I do, but I didn't see it in the submission.
So the through care support officer arrangements that we had in place were set down in 2019 due to operational pressures that were being experienced at that time. And since then, there has not really been the opportunity to reinstate the through care support officer arrangements. What we have done is look at how best we can ensure that people are as well prepared as they can be pre-release. And there are through care arrangements that are now supported by third sector organisations, which come under, I think, the remit of Community Justice Scotland. They commissioned those through care support service arrangements. If there comes a point in time that we can look at restating it, then clearly I would want to do so. But at the moment, with the considerable pressures that we're experiencing, it's certainly not in the near future.
So the decision not to reinstate just now, is that simply due to budgetary pressures?
It's due to operating pressures. So the increase in the population, as I said, has put significant pressure on the organisation. We came out of the pandemic and hope to achieve a stable operating period with the population in particular, and that has unfortunately not materialised. In addition to that, we do have workforce challenges, as other parts of the public sector are experiencing as well. At the moment, we normally tend to operate within a 1% vacancy assumption, if possible. That is currently sitting at 2%. So there are staffing pressures as well, which would not allow me to consider any other type of service delivery at the current moment in time.
And the through care services from Community Justice that are in place, I believe, is it still the Wise Group in Sacro that manage them? Their cost of providing through care services don't come out your budget at all then?
No, they don't. No, they don't.
OK. Right. Well, and the Wise Group in Sacro, do they provide through care services for everybody? For all prisons, all populations?
To be honest, Mr McGregor, I don't have that information at the moment. My understanding is we still have support arrangements in place for women and for young people. How far that extends to the adult male population, I honestly wouldn't be able to answer, but I can come back to you on that.
No, that's OK. If you could come back, that's fine, but we can also get that information from other sources. One of the things I'll be asking the Cabinet Secretary about later, and we had Community Justice in last week, is the whole direction of the justice system in Scotland, and we're wanting, obviously, for less people to be in prison. I know even yourself, Teresa, and others agree with that, but it does feel like almost that we need to invest more in community justice in order to achieve that, but at the same time, it's the first thing to go when things get tough. Would you recognise that as part of the decisions that the SPS made when it came to through care? Because that was an absolutely invaluable service, and I think it's a service that's been highly praised across the board. HMPIS as well, I've said it's highly regrettable, and most folk who have come in and spoke to us at some point have praised the standard of the through care service that you used to have in place. What account did you take? Were those factors taken into account when you made those decisions around through care?
I think at the time the decision was made, as I said, the organisation was under considerable pressure with regards to the population. When we have significant population rises, the increased pressure that is experienced within the system affects not only the population and the people in our care, but it also affects the staff group as well. And that's why we need to ensure as far as possible that we retain the maximum operating capacity that we can to ensure that people are kept safe. That's our staff and those in our care as well. Because what happens is that there is a focus, as you rightly say, on doing what we have to do, so what we are legally required to do, and a lot of the transactional work that we are required to do takes up significant amounts of staff time, and what then results as a consequence of that is there's a deterioration in the amount of time that staff can spend on relationships and supporting people. And that leads to a deterioration in the sense of well-being, both for staff and for prisoners. So the decisions of that nature are not taken lightly, but have to be taken on the basis of the pressures that are being experienced by the organisation. And it was unfortunate that through care support was one of the things that had to go, but we have to keep our prison safe, we have to protect the public. All of those things we are expected of us on a daily basis, and therefore we have to prioritise that work.
Thanks for that. And it seems to be that these bulging prison populations are continuing to cause a whole host of issues.
Thank you. Russell Finlay and then Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. I've got two questions, one of which relates to Kilmarnock and one of which relates to Glasgow. The staff at HMP Kilmarnock are extremely anxious about the forthcoming transfer to the SPS, and I think that nothing they've heard today will go any way to reassuring them. The SPS have known about this transfer since 2019, yet just months out from it happening, the staff are being told, that you've got no idea how much it's going to cost to make the transfer or how much the running costs are going to be to the SPS. Is that not a complete dereliction?
Thank you for the question, Mr. Finlay. We have engaged with staff at Kilmarnock in a meaningful way for more than a year now. We have had two engagement sessions, which I have attended on both occasions. We've had over 100 staff attend both of those. The most recent one was in September. I have the team have ensured that there have been regular communications, so monthly communications with the staff group. The concerns and the issues that they are raising with us are not about the running costs or the cost to deliver the services. They're clearly more personal to them. So we are about to enter a phase of one-to-ones with each of the staff to have informed discussions about what the transfer means for them and the choices that they will need to make about their personal circumstances. We have also committed to providing rosters for them prior to the transfer in the middle of March. And again, those are the kinds of things that are important to staff. What does this mean for me? How is it going to affect the quality time off that I have with my family? So things like rostering are really important. So those things that are important to staff as individuals, we are responding to. We are taking on board questions. There is a mechanism through which Serco staff can contact the project team direct and they can raise any questions or concerns, as well as doing so through the local management team.
I understand.
And we are responding to those.
Can I just interject? Sorry, I don't want to interrupt. We've got very little time. The staff indeed have concerns. For example, they're going to lose their body-worn cameras. They're going to go from an electronic system for HR, holidays and so on to a paper-based SPS system, which just seems regressive to me and to them. But what I think I'm surprised at, and they're surprised at, is that the SPS are sitting here in front of us today unable to say how much the transfer is going to be or how much the running costs are going to be. Can you explain that?
So there are a number of factors. Do you want to come in on that one, Jerry? But I can come back to it as well, Mr.
Okay. I mean, we are not just going to come up in the last minute with a figure. The work has been going on for several months in preparing the budgets. It's tying in with the operational decisions that how we're going to operate the facility. As I said earlier, there's an impact across not just the budget, establishment budget at Kilmarnock, it's across all the budgets and across the SPS, which impacts on the impact on our utilities budget, our kind of all the support service budgets. As part of a process, all that budgeting work comes to a conclusion around December, in time for the kind of the annual budgeting process. So work has gone underway, and as part of that process, we will get information. We will then look at challenge that information. So I would say that we are looking at the budgets and we're analysing them, and we will come to a figure that we can accurately report.
Thank you. Okay, so the SPS have known about it for 4 years. It's 4 months away and we still don't know these numbers. Moving on to HMP Glasgow, in your earlier answer, Mr. O'Donnell, you said that you...
Can I just come in? Again, I know this is important to discuss, but I think I'm trying to make sure that we're focusing on pre-budget scrutiny, and I'm quite happy for Ms. Medhurst and Mr. O'Donnell to follow up specific queries which relate to staff in writing. I really want this is about budget.
Absolutely. Well, I mean, you know, this is about budget in relation to Kilmarnock, but also the next question is specifically in relation to budget for HMP Glasgow and the impact that will have on the SPS. The SPS capital budget for 24-25 was 192 million. 25-26 will be 80 million. And I've not done this in chronological order, but 23-24 is 97 million. Now, the total for those 3 years is less than the projected or speculated £400 million that the new HMP Glasgow is going to cost. First of all, is 400 million the most up-to-date figure? And how on earth can you expect to pay for it, given these sums?
So I think two questions from you, Mr. Finlay. So the budget or the figures for Glasgow will be known once we have finalised the design and that has gone out for costing. So we are still working through that process.
Can I just quickly interrupt? Is the 400 million figure a figure that you're familiar with? That came from the SPS as a guide price, or?
So that there were figures that were given in, yes, that I do. That was in part of the infrastructure investment programme, I think, which was again an indicative figure because the detailed work in relation to both the outline business case and the design had not been developed at that stage. And that is now well in train and will come to a conclusion next year. So at that stage, we will have an understanding of what the full implications are for the cost.
So, I mean, the background to this is the governor of HMP, Berlini, said over the summer that a catastrophic incident in the prison is a question of when, not if. HMP Glasgow, the replacement prison, was due to open in 2026, yet here we are now saying that it'll be another 12 months before we even know the cost of that. And as for an opening date, nobody knows. Is that a fair representation?
No, I don't think so, Mr. Finlay, if I can counter that, because the delivery date for Glasgow will be very much dependent on the second question that you asked, which was around the capital allocation that we are provided by government over the next few years. That will determine the cash flow and therefore the timescales for delivery.
Given the very real concerns around cost, and we don't know how much it will cost, are you having conversations with government about additional capital funding to meet the cost of HMP Glasgow?
We are in constant conversations with our colleagues in Scottish Government over both the capital budget allocations and the revenue budget as well.
OK, thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, Rona Mackay and then John Swinney.
OK, thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I wanted to ask you about your contract with GeoAmey, which I understand is around £240 million. There have been highly publicised problems with GeoAmey, and but one lawyer describing it as an absolute disgrace. In your written submission, you say that additional funding is likely to be required for that. I wonder if you could sort of reassure us or tell us, you know, how you would look to improve the service and what kind of additional funding are you looking at?
So there has been a lot of work undertaken this year in particular, Ms Mackay, because we operate the contract, but it's on behalf of the justice partners, so there are other key players, and any adjustments to the contract or adjustments to service are agreed through that partnership arrangement. So it's more complex than an SPS owned and run contract, if I can explain that to begin with. One of the biggest challenges, two of the biggest challenges with the GeoAmey contract. GeoAmey contract was awarded in 2019 and we hit the pandemic in 2020. And obviously court services and a lot of other services that GeoAmey would have expected to deliver against the original contract went down. And we were in a period of significant change and adjustment. And even since we have left the pandemic behind us, the way that all of the business that is incorporated within that contract was set in 2019 has changed. It's reconfigured. So court business isn't operating in the way that it operated before, where you would have big vehicles turning up at Berlini and Edinburgh and being full and distributing people around courts. The way that the courts have reset means that it's much smaller numbers requiring additional or more intense staffing profile. Our business has changed significantly as well in terms of our demands in relation to things like hospital escorts have increased and they are quite staff intensive. So all of GUAME's work is fairly staff intensive. They have experienced workforce challenges as well. And what that has meant is that their workforce has dropped by 25%. So it's operating at a level which means that the service delivery is not able to manage the demands that we are placing on them. So that has required recalibration, not just within the contract, but within Justice Partners as well, to reset the demands on GUAME as well as provide some additional resource in order to ensure that they can improve their staffing profile, because it is boots on the ground that will make the difference. So that's recently been agreed. We were able to secure additional funds from Scottish Government to support that, and we have made agreed changes to the contract arrangements with our partners and with GUAME that are now in place. The workforce also were balloted on additional an increase in their pay rates, which went through resoundingly this week. So we are seeing the slowdown of the attrition from GUAME staff has started to happen. And although it's small numbers, nevertheless, there are additional 20 staff this month than they had a couple of months ago. So things are improving. We are monitoring on a month-to-month basis, and we are reviewing the revision in the contract arrangements on a four-monthly basis to ensure that the performance levels absolutely increase. Okay.
So the four-monthly basis that you just said, does that mean that you're monitoring it? If you don't see an improvement, is there an end to the situation? Is there a cut-off point where you say, well, things haven't improved? And my other question was about GUAME's staffing. I mean, do we know why they'd reached such a sort of crisis point? Was it due to Brexit, due to them not paying their staff enough? And they are a private company, so, it doesn't seem like a satisfactory arrangement, or it certainly hasn't. I mean, I'm hoping from what you've said that you've been in discussions with the other partners. As you say, it's quite a complex picture, but are you confident that things are going to improve with them from now on?
I think the changes that we've made should see an improvement, and we are seeing even already some green shoots of that improvement. Mm-hmm. And the fact that the staff did accept, because they were made a pay offer earlier in the year, which they didn't accept, but they are doing so now. Their pay rates aren't a factor, but equally, I think workforce expectations have changed. So people want flexible working, they want the ability to have some home working as well, and clearly GUAME can offer some of those flexibilities that potentially other employers can offer. Mm-hmm. So the four-monthly reviews are very much set in mind with there are thresholds with which we expect them to meet, and if those aren't met, then we can either go back to the original contract, which will mean that there will be significant penalties applied to GUAME. But there are in the background obviously ongoing discussions around mitigations and contingencies that are taking place with our Justice Partners.
And were any other alternative suppliers looked at during the period of trouble once it was clear that there were such problems? And I understand you told us the reasons for those, but are you kind of just stuck with GUAME, or can you look around?
What I would say to that, Ms Mackay, is nothing's off the table. Mm-hmm. We are looking at all available options to us. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can... I've got two more members wishing to come in. If I can just ask for fairly succinct responses to questions. John Swinney and then Katie Clark.
Thank you, Kavira. I wonder if I could ask what is the month during the year at which the inflation rate for the private sector contract, private prison contracts, is set?
It varies. For the Arriwell contract, it's September.
September.
September, and I believe GOA in Amy and Kilmarnock is December.
December, OK. I take it that the contracts that provide for that, sorry, I take it that those provisions are built into the contract at the point of negotiation.
Yes.
So essentially, the private sector contracts were inflation-proofed at the time of the agreement of the contracts. I wonder if you could explain to me what is the risk transfer involved in that, whereby the private sector is protected from the rampant inflation that the public sector is having to face?
Mr. Sway, the issue is that it's a 25-year contract, and at the start of that contract, obviously, there's a forecast is taken out. But yes, at that point, is risk is determined, and I suppose that in a low a period where there's low inflation, low CPI and RPI, there's a greater risk with the private sector contract, the private sector. But in this period of time, when RPI and CPI is at high levels, then obviously there's significant cost increases for the public.
So how I would interpret that, Mr. O'Donnell, which I think is a completely fair observation from you, is that the private sector essentially is insulated from the effect of inflation, and the public sector carries the can. So the argument that these contracts represent some degree of risk transfer is complete baloney.
I couldn't disagree with that, Mr. Swain.
Thank you. Now, if I could move on to the capital cost issue. Have you any current experience of what is the real increase in capital costs in the current environment? So I suppose I'm probably talking there about this financial year versus what you would have expected the capital costs to be, let's say, 3 years ago. So what I'm trying to get at is, are you able to give the committee, for a particular project, we expected it 2 years ago to have cost £20 million, but it has in fact cost us £20 million plus X. Are you able to furnish the committee with any live examples of that? Because I think that would be a helpful piece of data.
Yes. I think post-pandemic, there was probably a backlog of projects. So I think one of the challenges has been that we are in a marketplace where there's a lot of construction projects going on. So therefore, going out to tender in the supply chain makes it very difficult to get competitive prices back. And quite often, you've only got one supplier coming back with a price. And therefore, it's very difficult to get a kind of competitiveness in there at times. I do think there is a significant supply chain issues in the construction industry in terms of labour, and that's as a result probably pre-pandemic with Brexit and freedom of movement. I also believe that, you know, construction inflation is significant in terms of, you know, the fuel, etc., and energy costs. So yes, it's a marketplace that has seen significant rises in inflation, as in many other marketplaces as well, but particularly in construction. And it has made costs of projects significantly more expensive than a few years ago.
So the long and the short of it is that for the Scottish Prison Service, finding itself in a position to deliver capital projects in the aftermath of COVID is stung by the combination of an intensely competitive marketplace because of the backlogs of construction projects, supply chain cost increases, which are fueled by Brexit, the loss of freedom of movement, the increase in fuel costs, all of which beyond the control of the Scottish Prison Service, and the challenges about securing appropriate workforce to deliver these projects. And that's the context in which you're trying to rejuvenate your estate.
I would agree with that entirely, Mr. Swinney.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you.
And Katie Clark.
Thank you. I'd like to ask about budgetary issues in relation to Greenock. And you've outlined to Pauline McNeill the long lead-in times these kind of projects can incur, and there's obviously plans for a new build at Inverclyde. So can you say whether any work has started in relation to that? And in terms of the current estate and the fabric of HMP Greenock and the conditions that your staff and the prisoners are having to endure, can you outline the budgetary implications? Because there's substantial work, as I understand it, going on in relation to the walls. And could you give an update in relation to that and the budgetary implications?
I'll take this question, Ms Clark. So in Greenock, in terms of a replacement prison, I think it's still in the future pipeline, but no dates have been set. And in maintaining the existing establishment, we've undertaken a number of areas to improve the establishment. So we have, there was a number of cells out of use because of dampness, etc. And you know, budgetary constraints prevented us from doing kind of full kind of.
I do understand all that. Could you maybe say how much you've spent and how much you envisage spending? And if it is that you're not able to do the work that you really think is necessary, that would be helpful for the committee to understand.
I don't have exact numbers, but I can provide you with information in due course.
Thank you.
But what I can say is that we are going out to tender for roofing works. We're getting, kitchens are being redesigned. And there is, as I say, work being undertaken this year to bring cells back into use.
Okay, sorry to cut you short. It's just that we're obviously tight for time. But if you could share that information with the committee, that would be very much appreciated. And as you know, Scottish Government policy is very much in favour of rehabilitation. However, there is a disconnect between, if you like, policy and what is happening in the justice system, both within the prison estate, but also outside of the prison estate in other parts of the justice system. So in relation to the prison service, how are you dealing with that disconnect, and what are you doing to try and ensure that you're able to expand the rehabilitation programmes that are available within the prison estate? I mean, to use an example, we're often told that sex offenders who are voluntarily asking to have access to programmes and other forms of rehabilitation are not able to get that because it's just not there. So could you perhaps explain how you're trying to make that shift within the budgets that you have?
So I suppose a couple of things on that, Ms Clark. I think what we are doing in prisons at the moment in Scotland is we have been recalibrating some of our delivery around rehabilitation to particularly focus on health, well-being and people who use drugs and alcohol. So there has been much more focus on that, given that a significant proportion of our population are affected. With regards to programme delivery and progression, prior to the pandemic, because of the slow, steady increase of long-term prisoners, prior to the pandemic, we had pressures in those areas anyway, and we had looked at a number of different ways and means that we could readjust not just the programme delivery, but how we constructed our resource to do so. That was paused by the pandemic, but clearly during that time, there has being created an even bigger backlog. So as a matter of priority, we are focusing some time and resource on our case management system and also on our delivery of programmes in order to ensure that we are future-proofed and not just dealing with the backlog.
And what does that mean in budgetary terms? Because there's two issues, either putting more money in or trying to make better use of the money that's already there for that purpose. So can you maybe say, are you putting any more money in? Are you able to do that, given all the pressures on you? Or are you having to cut back in financial terms? And are you trying to do it, if you like, better to make it more efficient? Could you maybe explain briefly? It's the strategy.
It's all of those things. So it's making best use of our staff time. So a move to in-cell technology, which would free staff up from transactional work and allow them more time to do the relational work and case management systems, allowing greater access to online, in-cell services such as education services, because that contract is currently, or our learning strategy is currently being revisited, and the contract will be re-let. So there are a number of different strands to that, but I would be happy to give you more detail on that.
That would be helpful, and I appreciate, I may be asking how long is a piece of string, but you know, it's clear there is a disconnect, and it's clear that the service has not been provided in the way that I suspect all of us would like it to happen. Now, there's an unlimited amount of money, sure, I'm sure, that you could spend on these things, but have you looked at how much it would actually cost to deliver an adequate service in terms of, you know, programmes and other forms of rehabilitation? And could you advise the committee of what you think really we should be spending compared with what you're able to spend? And I do understand completely the pressures on the service, particularly as prison numbers are increasing and are likely to continue to increase. So I'm not being critical, because I understand the pressures, but I'm trying to understand what that disconnect is and whether that's something, you're doing work on and actively engaging with, and whether you could share with that with the committee, perhaps in writing.
So I would be happy to respond to all of that in writing, Ms Clark.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. We'll have to draw this session to a close, so thanks to our witnesses for attending this morning, and we'll just have a short suspension to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you, members. I'm now pleased to welcome our second panel to the meeting this morning for our final evidence session on pre-budget scrutiny. So welcome to Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Ms Katrina Dalrymple, Interim Director of Justice, and Mr Donald McGilvery, Director of Safer Communities at the Scottish Government. So I'm going to allow around 90 minutes for this session, and my intention is to broadly cover the following areas in turn, so if you can bear with me. So we'll start with Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, then we'll move to community justice questions, then policing, courts and prosecution services, prisons, and then any other parts of the justice sector that members may wish to ask questions around. So as you can see, we've got a lot of ground to cover, so can I ask members, as usual, to keep questions as succinct as possible. If we don't manage to get through all the questions, we can send the remainder in writing seeking a response. So I'll now start with a general opening question, and then I'll open it up to members for anything similar before I move on to the Fire and Rescue Service. So, Cabinet Secretary, it will be of no surprise that virtually every organisation that we've heard from have painted a stark picture of their finances, with capital budgets under significant pressure, and all have said their finances are insufficient, and many have said that they have cut as far as they can. So what is the possibility for a change that might address this? And have you had any discussions so far with the Cabinet Secretary for Finance on the scope for further investment, particularly if this was on a spend-to-save basis?
Good morning, Convener, and thank you very much for that. I mean, as you specifically mention capital budgets, I will start my remarks with that. It is no secret to say that capital is under extreme pressure. The UK government have not inflation-proofed capital. So what we will see for the financial year 24-25 is nearly a 4% real terms reduction. And we will see nearly a 7% real terms reduction by 27-28. So the capital position is particularly stretched, it is particularly severe. We have some prominent commitments, particularly in and around the prison estate. I've had many discussions with the Deputy First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. As you would expect, there is an intensive amount of engagement at this stage prior to the budget. Obviously, the budget will be published in due course, and it will be for Parliament as a whole to scrutinise that and to agree to that budget or not.
OK, thank you very much. I'm just going to go straight to other members for their questions. If there's nobody looking to ask a general opening question, then we'll move to... Russell. We'll move to Fire and Rescue Services. And I'm actually going to bring in Katie Clark and then Sharon Dowie, and then I'll come to you.
Thank you. Katie Clark. Cabinet Secretary, you will be aware of the campaign for additional funding from the Scottish Government for the Fire Service, spearheaded by FBU Scotland. And no doubt you've seen their Firestorm report. There's been a decade of real-term cuts to the Fire Service, and I think it's fair to say a lack of investment, particularly capital investment, but other investment over many years. So what you're now facing is cumulative. Do you believe that we're now in a position where we're legally exposed as a result of, for example, the failure to provide safe systems of work and the failure to have adequate decontamination available for firefighters?
Thanks to Ms Clark. There's a number of issues there. I would, of course, acknowledge that in the same way that households up and down the country are challenged because of a cost of living crisis and public services, you know, are indeed across the board challenged on the back of a decade of austerity. I should point out that in terms of this government's record in investing in justice, that we have, you know, continued to make year-on-year increases in investment.
Focused on fire, because we'll be coming up to the other issues. Yeah.
I am indeed focused on fire, because it's you know, a general point that is applicable to fire. The fire budget for this year increased by £14 million in comparison to the previous year. And the point that I would like to make is that the budget for this year was certainly in a better position than was at the case at pre-budget scrutiny. So there is a role, a very important role for pre-budget scrutiny. We will, of course, continue to work with both the FBU and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. Ministers continue to receive assurances, whether that's from the His Majesty Inspectorate or indeed Chief Fire Officers, that we have a safe service. There are, of course, choices and challenges to address. No one for one moment is disputing that. But we have continued to make year-on-year increased investment into fire services. And indeed, when you compare the current budget from 2017-18, investment is £55 million higher. And of course, people are entitled to argue for more. There will be an issue for Parliament to identify if we are investing more in one area, where that comes from, bearing in mind that the Scottish Government as a whole has to operate within a financial envelope and that our abilities to raise revenue are somewhat limited.
Do you accept that firefighters currently lack suitable decontamination facilities?
So I do think that's an important issue in terms of the welfare of staff. It is an issue that the Scottish Government is engaged on, again, both with the FBU and the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. I know that there is procedures, operational procedures in place, particularly for some of those more rural stations in and around decontamination procedures. And that's important that as a government we have, you know, contributed to research on the health impacts for firefighters and, you know, are supportive of additional health screening.
Well, firefighters have told me that guidance hasn't been issued. I understand it's been worked on. So perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could get back in terms of guidance being issued by the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, who told the committee that their capital funding has remained at £32.5 million over the last 7 years, yet they need at least £60 million per annum of investment. Does she feel that that level of underfunding is acceptable?
So, I mean, I would dispute whether it is underfunded as such. I mean, I think you are right to point out that people will always make a case for more. That's the function of pre-budget scrutiny. It is rare for any organisation to be able to address all their capital needs within 1 year. That's why when the Deputy First Minister publishes the budget, she will also publish a multi-year indicative spend in terms of resource and capital. Now, in the longer term, that, of course, doesn't replace the annual budget process, but it does allow people, you know, the opportunity to plan ahead. As I said, capital is extremely stretched. Capital funding has been maintained at £32 million for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, but there remains deep pressure on capital budgets.
I am going to have to bring another members, but if we have time at the end, very happy to bring members back with any outstanding questions. Sharon Dowie and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. At the committee's last pre-budget scrutiny, Ross Haggart stated that the fire service may have to save £14 million next year on the basis of the flat cash budget, and that was a conservative estimate. That would equate to 339 full-time equivalent officers and 18 fewer appliances that could be crewed. What's your response to that comment?
Well, I mean, I'm conscious that many organisations, including the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, have submitted their evidence to this committee, and that much of that is based on the resource spending review of May 2022. I would point to the fact that the current year's budget it was in a better place than that resource spending review that was published in May last year. And I will, you know, continue to do my best to argue and negotiate for the best possible deal for all justice organisations. I mean, what I would say is that, as with any estimate of savings that will have to be made, they are based on various assumptions, whether that is around inflation, pay increases, you know, future financial commitments and future budgets, all variables that can change, as we've seen with this year's budget, because we have seen, you know, some of the highest levels of inflation in more than a generation, and that, of course, has had an impact on the Scottish Fire Service and indeed other justice organisations.
Are you concerned about the safety aspects of them not getting enough budget, just with the... If appliances are unable to be crewed, it's going to be an increase in response time, particularly I've got quite a big rural area that I cover, so the response times would be reduced there. So are you worried about the ability of the fire service to respond quickly to fires if they don't get further funding that they need?
So I think it's important to remember that the number of fires has reduced in the last 20 years, and that, of course, is to the credit of firefighters. It is my understanding that it was many years ago that the fire service moved away from having targets around response times. Instead, they have a targeted approach around risk and the allocation of resources. I know, I don't know if it was this Justice Committee or a previous one, you know, was not convinced that time targets around response times was the best way to go. So bearing in mind that in terms of the preponderance and incidence of both dwelling fires and primary fires, that we are in a safer place because fires have reduced. But nonetheless, community safety is a priority, and we'll continue to do what we can to support people with as much resource as can be afforded.
Okay. Just one last question. The retained duty system service, which provides the primary fire cover for around 80% of the geography in Scotland, is losing one-tenth of its on-call firefighters every year and can't recruit or retain enough replacements. What additional funding could you provide to address the vacancy level and ensure that the terms and conditions are standardised for retained firefighters?
So I think it's important to acknowledge that this isn't so much a resource issue. It is much more an issue in and around recruitment that exists across the UK. When I visited the Inveraray fire station a month or so ago, they certainly spoke to me about the challenges for rural communities, particularly in terms of recruitment and retention of retained firefighters. So it is something that we are, you know, actively engaged with SFRS on in terms of, you know, what more can be done in and around recruitment and how to more effectively recruit and retain staff.
Okay, thank you. Russell Finlay.
Thanks very much. The FBU's Firestorm report is sobering and indeed deeply concerning. Of course, you know, inflationary issues have contributed to the capital backlog, but this has been a decade of accumulated underspend. And the most recent figure put forward by the FBU is actually over £800 million. I think that's something that the SFRS don't disagree with. Firefighters say that they are being put at risk because of this. They say the public are being put at risk by this. And they say that firefighters are also not having the required decontamination facilities. So given the scale of this backlog, is it now reached a point where you're having critical discussions with Scottish Government about additional funding, more over and above what might be committed in the budget? And is there now an argument for this being subject to perhaps the Royal Commission?
I would dispute that, Mr. Finlay, with respect.
Which part is disputed?
The Royal Commission.
You would not think there's a need?
No. No, I mean, there is, of course, you know, a place, you know, for in-depth inquiries, but they don't come without a financial cost. So if you had to ask me to make a choice between investing in frontline services some sort of further inquiry, I would opt to invest in frontline services. Again, I mean, it is important to recognise that fires and fire deaths in domestic premises, you know, have reduced in the last 5 years. I do accept the point that in terms of facilities, that is important that workers are afforded dignity, safety and, of course, privacy as well. Despite a challenging situation in the past, you know, we have maintained capital spend at £32.5 million, and it's not just the inflationary pressures, although I would point to the inflationary pressures on the construction services and the cost of basic materials to replace buildings has certainly rocketed thanks to record-breaking UK-wide inflation and indeed other matters such as Brexit. But there has been a proactive decision by the UK government not to increase capital funding, not to inflation-proof that. So that does give us some challenges and we will have to prioritise in terms of safety, because safety is a priority. And we also have His Majesty's Spectre of Fire Services, who provide that independent oversight of fire and rescue services as well, which should give us all some assurance.
Sure. I mean, it's been a decade of underspend, year after year after year, and that's the decisions made by the Scottish Government. On that basis, is there an argument that more money should be forthcoming to go some way to addressing this £800 million plus backlog in capital expenditure?
I won't argue with you that we've certainly had a decade of austerity, and that has had an impact on decisions that we were able to make and decisions that we will be able to make going forward. But as I pointed out in an earlier answer, I will always do my best to negotiate the best possible deal for all justice organisations, and that our discussions within government are indeed intense on these matters, and particularly bearing in mind the volume of pre-budget evidence that's been submitted to this committee.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, I'm going to move us on and ask members to come in on questions around community justice. So I'm going to kick off with Fulton McGregor, then John Swinney.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to Cabinet Secretary and officials. We had community justice in last week. Cabinet Secretary, you might have seen the evidence session. And what we heard during that was quite a strong case that perhaps there's a disconnect of some sort between policy intention of the Scottish Government within the justice sector and how it's actually operating in terms of budgets. And what they really meant by that is while we're focusing, or we have to focus because of large numbers on prisons and things like that, the community sector the community justice sector's budget has remained very small in comparison with the rest of the sector and fairly static, and therefore it's hindering the chances and the opportunities to actually change the shift between the way that we all want it. I've probably asked that question the long way around. Apologies, Cabinet Secretary. But is that something that you would agree with? Would you agree with that kind of overall analysis?
So, I mean, I think there's an alignment with the Justice Vision and with the National Strategy for Community Justice and the delivery plans in and around that. There's nothing new in the delivery plans, but, you know, they are, you know, continuing putting our words into practice. And there is the transformational change programme, particularly around shifting the balance from prison to community justice. I would say that the overall budget for this year for community justice is £134 million, and that includes the continuation of additional investment of £15 million, which essentially began in 22-23 to support pandemic recovery efforts and to bolster capacity. But there's no doubt about it that the early intervention that we want to see within justice services actually, you know, applies beyond justice services as well, so that the broader government agenda in and around early intervention and prevention, whether that's, you know, in health, early years, you know, social security, employability, is all crucially important too. What I would agree with is that there is a very strong argument to be picking up the pace in achieving our ambitions in and around community justice, bearing in mind the situation we're in with a growing prison population.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. And is there any, plans in this budget about how we might do that, how we might pick up the pace? I mean, even just to give an example, in the previous session here with the Scottish Prison Service, I asked about through care, and the through care service that the Prison Service previously ran was a very well, highly respected one, and it's obviously been pulled as prison population has grown and the pressures that's put on their staff. But it does seem to be that whenever something has to give, it seems to be the community justice sort of side that has to go, and that's an example of that. So is there anything that can be done through the budget process, through the upcoming budget, to try and increase that pace that I think we all want to see? And I don't think there's any doubt, and I don't think a single member around this table would doubt the Scottish Government's policy intentions in this area are to reduce our prison population and enhance community justice.
So, I mean, obviously, the budget for the next financial year is still to be published and agreed. In terms of the changes that SPS made to their through care arrangements, I mean, they date back to 2019. What I will be ensuring is that the years, calendar years 24-25 will be our implementation period for the Bail and Release Act. And I don't need to rehearse the arguments that were made in this committee, you know, underpinning the focus on through care and starting to plan for people's release on admission to prison if they are, you know, subject to, you know, remand or indeed a determinate sentence. I do think when I undoubtedly will be coming back to Parliament to discuss issues in and around how we address a rising prison population. And I am strongly of the view that the actions we take to address that now also have to be actions that will address the issue in the future as well. So we do need to adopt approaches that are not just short-term responses, but are also for the longer term also.
Thanks. One more question.
Very quickly.
Yeah, I know that. I just wanted to ask about the funding, the multi-year funding model for third sector bodies. Do you agree that if it was multi-year, it could be helpful longer term, or are you quite happy with the current model? And the reason why I ask that is because even in the last session, there we were talking about the through care model being replaced by third sector organisations like SACRO and the WISE group, who I do think do an absolutely fantastic job. But do you think that there is an argument for multi-year funding for these sort of organisations within the justice sector?
I do think there are very pragmatic arguments in favour of that in terms of enabling, as you'd suggest, Mr McGregor, around voluntary organisations being put in a more secure, stable footing. We have adopted that approach with the Victim Centred Approach Fund. That's a £48 million fund over 3 years. But I'm just going to be really upfront with committee and direct. Multi-year funding is somewhat challenging when you operate in a single-year budgeting. And if I give you an overview of the justice portfolio budget, I mean, well over 70% of that goes towards staffing costs. And we've obviously had very welcome pay increases for frontline staff. We will then have, around 15 to 20% that will meet our statutory commitments, and then around 5% of what our budget is goes towards voluntary organisations.
Okay, thanks, Cabinet Secretary.
Okay, thank you. John Swinney, then Katie Clark.
Thank you, Convener. It's very obvious that there is intense financial pressure on the government and on public services after the impact of austerity, Brexit, and the spiralling, punitive impact of inflation. So I certainly don't underestimate the financial pressures on the government. But in that context, it strikes me that the comments, Cabinet Secretary, that you put on the record about the importance of picking up the pace on preventative services is absolutely critical, because it looks, to all intents and purposes, that the government is in a bit of a bind with a rising prison population, which is a more expensive problem to service than preventative services, which are much more affordable and in some circumstances produce better outcomes. So what I'm interested in is what impetus is being given across government to make the shift into preventative services that the Cabinet Secretary highlighted, because I recognise this is not just a justice compartment issue, this is a wider issue across government. Is the Cabinet focusing its discussions on how that shift might be made to reduce the higher cost custodial service that is being supported, with a greater priority being allocated towards preventative interventions?
So, to be blunt, doing nothing in terms of doing more to move towards preventative services and early intervention isn't an option. And we can see that with the very obvious example around the rise in prison population, and it could also apply to other justice services as well. And in essence, in terms of that broad strategic approach, we need to reduce demand for some services, and you can only do that by acting earlier. And in terms of our precious resources, we do need to also, where possible, commit to, have a longer term vision in and around spend to save, whether that's around some digital investment, for example. But the evidence tells us that while there is always a place for prisons and there will always be people who will require to be in custody, that the use of a robust community supervision is far more effective at reducing reoffending than, for example, a short-term custodial sentence, because in some circumstances, prison is indeed an expensive way of making things worse. In terms of the cross-government point, I think that is well understood. If I use one example, the over-representation of care leavers within our prison system. So that means the investment in community justice or the rehabilitation programmes in prisons isn't just important to me, it's also an investment in and around the early years, supporting families and the promise. There is obviously work that we are doing within justice around the Bairnshus pathways. All of that will lead to a different approach in supporting children and victims. And the proceeds of crimes money goes towards investment in diversion activities for young people. And I think in its history has supported, hundreds of thousands of young people. And I think the current programme will benefit around, 33,000 young people across the country.
So is this then the moment for the government to be bold about the challenge it puts in front of a range of organisations, all of whom are in front of this committee asking for more money, to basically say we've got to have a shift of our focus because we can't go on like this?
Indeed, because I say this with the greatest and the greatest respect to the many, many valued stakeholders who have came to committee and given detailed evidence, both in person and in writing. But if I add up all of those asks, I can't meet all of those asks. And I might as well just be, I'm just being dead straight with committee about that. So that means, we will have to do things differently and leverage in, incentives within the resources we do have to see where people can do things such as spend to save, where we can continue. Our journey with public sector reform is not over. We will still have examples, whether that's in justice or across the public sector, of services being delivered in a way that, may meet the needs of the institution or the organisation, but not the individuals, in that the perennial challenge of being able to support people earlier on in their life's journey, which will prevent problems further down the line.
So, lastly, Convener, is there an argument then where better outcomes are being achieved for money to be allocated to other purposes because better outcomes have been achieved, rather than an argument that there can only be an increase in money allocated to a particular organisation or policy area because that's what gets argued for in a pre-budget process?
So the ultimate assessment always has to be better outcomes. Crime is going down, fires are going down. How do we have services where we're reaching people earlier? How do we have services where it's appropriate, we're preventing people going to prison? Because that isn't just in the interest of individual, it's in the interest of our communities and our country. So we do need to move a debate from quantum to quality and to one of change, notwithstanding that there are undoubtable difficulties with the financial envelope that's available to us.
Thank you, Kavir.
Okay, thank you. Katie Clark and then Rona Mackay, and then we'll move on.
Thank you. In 2019, the Parliament passed legislation to enable GPRS electronic monitoring and bracelets that monitor alcohol use to be used. Both of those technologies obviously have the capacity and potential to reduce reoffending. I met and visited G4S relatively recently, and I understand that they haven't been asked to start work on those initiatives. And I know that the Cabinet Secretary, I think, visited shortly before me, so I suspect she's been looking at these issues. So is she now trying to get this work started?
So I think there's two aspects to Ms Clark's question. And yes, indeed, I visited the premises in East Kilbride to be able to appraise myself of the further advantages of GPS technology. I have commissioned my officials to explore that work. I would hope to keep Parliament abreast of that. We have seen success with the, for example, the increase in the electronic monitoring with bail. It is a good example of the use of technology that is to not just the benefit of individuals and families, but also in the long run to communities. And it's an important part of the jigsaw in terms of community payback orders. Community payback orders can have a very wide range of conditions attached to them, and I would like to see that fuller spectrum of conditions utilised, and that's something that I have just very recently discussed with Social Work Scotland about how we can move forward and do that.
If I could ask just a very general follow-up question in relation to that. This Parliament passed that legislation in 2019, and a huge amount of scrutiny goes into legislation. The expectation from MSPs when we pass legislation is that it's going to be enacted pretty much immediately. It seems to be a theme that that legislation gets passed and it doesn't necessarily happen. Is that something that the Cabinet Secretary is concerned about?
Well, Ms Clark, I'm always a woman in a hurry. But there are obvious, you know, financial constraints which inevitably, means that choices are made in and around the implementation of legislation. And that is nothing new. In broad terms, governments should be upfront when legislation is going through about what our anticipated implementation timescales are. And sometimes, you know, for very good reasons, there has to be a phasing in of reforms and legislative changes. And particularly with the pandemic, there has had to be a phasing in of reforms so we don't overwhelm systems.
Come back to that. I'll bring in Rona Mackay and then we'll move on to questions around policing.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to just ask a couple of questions around the Scottish Government's commitment to combating violence against women and girls. And I wondered if you could maybe identify or break down how that budget's been spent and what you imagine. I appreciate you might not have that to hand and writing would be fine if you don't have it. That's my first question. You could maybe address that.
So I know from my previous posts of the importance of the Equally Safe Fund, the Delivering Equally Safe Fund, that is obviously work that is of still paramount importance to the justice sector, although it sits in another portfolio. The Delivering Equally Safe Fund is £19 million per year, and it supports 121 projects from 112 organisations. In terms of my own portfolio, I mentioned the Victim Centred Approach Fund, which is the £48 million over 23 years. There is a big part of that, £18.5 million, which is for specialist advocacy in response to gender-based violence.
Can you say, how does that line up with the Istanbul Convention, which was passed fairly recently, and what their estimation would be needed?
Yeah, so I was an advocate in a previous life for the incorporation of the Istanbul Convention and worked very closely with Westminster colleagues to, you know, pursue that at a UK level. The Istanbul Convention you know, is looking for action around prevention to combat all forms of violence against women and girls, and in particular for policies to be integrated, so integrated on a cross-government basis, and I suppose be able to measure measure the impact of our programmes as well.
Thank you. Final question would be, Scottish Women's Aid have raised on numerous occasions the issue of the domestic abuse survivors being able to access eligibility to legal aid, and I wonder if you could enlighten us about, have you any plans to try and address that situation and the availability of legal aid solicitors, basically, because that seems to be a huge gaping hole in the Justice Department.
Okay. We have a very generous legal aid system that compares well to many or most of our European counterparts. There is our civil legal aid. It has a very wide scope. And there has been a number of uplifts to legal aid, four uplifts since 2019. And there has been an additional resource of £31 million since 2021, and the latest uplift of £11 million from memory equates to a 10% increase. So we do invest heavily in legal aid, and we also support the Scottish Women's Rights Centre as well. And there is a pilot project that we are supporting with up to around £400,000 over a period of 3 years. And that's a pilot that's been established through the Scottish Legal Aid Board to support Scottish women's aids, the provision of legal advice to women affected by gender-based violence, and that has been taken forward in collaboration with Edinburgh's Women's Aids and a firm of solicitors. And just in terms of the point about solicitors, the Minister for Victims and Community Safety jointly chairs a working group which is about the future of the legal profession, which of course is about diversity but is also about capacity.
Well, that's quite encouraging, and I think the funds that you mentioned might go somewhere to some way to alleviating the issue of the lack of legal aid solicitors available in time, and it would help women who've suffered violence. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'm going to move to questions around policing. We've got three more areas that members are interested in: policing, courts, and prisons. We've got a wee bit of time. But I'll bring in Russell Finlay to kick things off.
Thanks very much. The Scottish Police Federation, David Kennedy from the SPF, has described policing in Scotland as having been, the phrase he used, asset-stripped over the past decade, with over 140 police stations being closed and a reduction in the number of officers. We've heard similar concerns in the past from the previous Chief Constable and others in policing. And I just wonder generally what the government is intending to do to deal with the capital backlog in relation to policing.
Convener, I suppose I would dispute the phrase asset stripped. It is true and a matter of public record that the formation of Police Scotland into a national police service from eight legacy services, you know, has indeed resulted in savings of £200 million a year, which of course is, you know, a resource that is available for other public services. And that is a good example of public sector reform where savings have been released. And we can also take assurance from His Majesty's Inspector of Constabulary of Police in Scotland, who has time and time again spoke of our outstanding operational policing services. I think I've spoken a fair amount of length around the challenges in and around Capital. The Police Scotland have their estates strategy, which has a very firm focus on co-location and co-location of public services, not just because of the financial challenges that we all face, but actually in terms of more collaborative working always seems like a sensible proposition to me. I know that Police Scotland have, in terms of co-location projects, probably now instigated over 60 of those. There is one in my own constituency. So, you know, reshaping the estate in light of Capital challenges seems like a sensible thing to do, but it can also lead to a better way of working. In terms of police officer numbers, we have 370 more officers than we did in 2007. Police Scotland has, since the beginning of 2022, recruited nearly 1,500 new recruits. We have 30 police officers per 10,000 of the population in comparison to 25 per 10,000 of the population south of the border. So policing, in terms of what it is achieving, in terms of the investment and in terms of police numbers, I would contend is secure and stable.
I mean, we can debate police officer numbers all day long and interpret statistics in our own way, but one thing that we can agree on is that Police Scotland officers uniquely in the United Kingdom don't have the protection of body-worn cameras. Now, this the provision of these was a commitment made by the First Minister on at least two occasions, but the most recent response to the budget for Police Scotland is that they may not have the money to implement these and to bring these in, give officers this protection. Is that something that you're concerned about, that specific area? And is there anything that could be done to assure officers that they will get these cameras?
So we have still to set the budget, but I do accept the point, Mr. Finlay, that body-worn cameras are a priority for the Scottish Government. First Minister, as you said, has spoken of that on a number of occasions. And in terms of the evidence that Police Scotland gave to this committee, they made clear that it is also a priority for them. Body-worn cameras, I believe, are a good example of investing to save. They are a good example of reforming how the business is done. It will lead to more effectiveness and efficiency, you know, perhaps in and around the provision of evidence. And there is also an important point about officer safety.
And do you have any idea of likely timescale? Can you give any sort of suggested timescale?
So the programme for government made a commitment about beginning to roll out body-worn cameras, that this government would support Police Scotland to begin that process in 2024, I think, to 14,000 police officers.
Summer 24 is the
wrong. Summer 24.
The beginning of the process?
Sorry, yes.
Yes.
Yes, beginning of the process.
And the completion, likely?
I mean, we wouldn't want to be taken forever and a day about it. But, you know, that will be finalised once the budget is finalised. But I hope I can convey to you, Mr. Finlay, and also to police officers, that the body-worn camera investment is indeed a priority.
OK, thank you very much. Thank you.
OK, thank you. I wonder if I can maybe just come in and follow up on the discussion around police officer and staff numbers. We know that those numbers have been falling and are predicted to be cut where there are, as a result of budgetary constraints. So I just wondered what your views are on this, in particular on the impact on policing in communities, which we know is something that communities and the public like to see. And I would add that, you know, I am aware that things like ICT development, where police officers, for example, now have electronic notebooks other than, as opposed to the old-fashioned paper notebooks that they used to use. And those, that development and that investment in ICT has significantly enabled police officers to remain in communities as opposed to having to always come back to a police station to write up notes, to write up details of cases and inquiries. So in terms of policing numbers, so police officer numbers, but also staff numbers, I'm just interested in, I suppose, seeking an assurance from the Cabinet Secretary that where possible, those numbers will be retained and not cut.
So the assurance I can give to this committee that I will work as hard as possible to get the best possible budget for Police Scotland, because I want the new Chief Constable to be able to make decisions as she sees fit in and around, you know, police numbers and the deployment of those resources. I know from my engagement thus far with the new Chief Constable that she is particularly focused on community policing and presence as a priority. I know, and it's always the case that in the lead up to budgets that people make predictions, and predictions have to be made on assumptions. But I point to the fact that where we ended up this year was a better financial position. And that the most recent quarterly statistics around police numbers show a stabilisation at 16,600. You know, we all value each and every police officer. We want to support them to work in communities, whether that's via, you know, technology or indeed other means.
Thanks very much. I think, John Swinney, you'd like to come in and then we'll move on.
Just one brief question, Convener. The Cabinet Secretary just referred there to the Chief Constable's priority around about community policing, which I understand and is welcome. But obviously the criminal threat that we as a society face is much broader than just community policing. So, for example, the sophistication of online activities to threaten the population, and the necessity for Police Scotland to have the necessary online skills might not lend itself to the traditional definition of police officers and police officer numbers being the best indicator of the strength and the effectiveness of Police Scotland. So to what extent is that changing nature of crime reflected in the dialogue with the Chief Constable and the Scottish Police Authority, and reflected in the budgetary choices that might be made?
So, I mean, what I observe and am part of, you know, across government and with my dialogue with the new Chief Constable as well as the previous one, and the my ongoing involvement with Police Scotland, is that at a strategic level they are, of course, indeed very focused on community policing. But that also applies to the threats that we, you know, experience on a more global or a more national basis. And the advantage of having a national police force is, of course, around the more flexible deployment of resources. Mr. Swinney, of course, is correct that crime is changing, the nature of crime is changing, and we only have to look at cybercrime as an example of that. And that will, of course, require different forms of expertise. And that's why it's important that I secure the best possible deal possible, so that the Chief Constable, who is better placed with respect than anybody sitting around this table, including me, to be making decisions on how best to combat that threat we face at a community or a national level, and how to deploy her resources to best effect.
But does that but is the nuance that I'm trying to get across of the nature of the skills that are required in Police Scotland for the policing challenge of today best served by a discussion about what are the number of police officers we have available to us?
So I suppose within Police Scotland, what I think Mr Swinney is driving at, that in terms of keeping our communities safe, that the debate is much broader than police officers, because it also has to include police staff and other associated professionals as well, who will bring, you know, various forensic skills to bear.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If there are no more questions on policing that members would like to ask, we'll move on to questions around courts, and I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay.
I wasn't expecting that, if someone else has got one, but I can certainly try and come up with it. I had a general question that might fit for courts.
Feel free.
So the most recent ruling in relation to corroboration not being required in some rape cases, SCTS expect this will result in a significant number of new prosecutions. Is that something the Scottish Government has analysed in any way and discussed with Scottish courts in terms of new workload and the cost of that?
So it's a very, very recent judgment, and I am conscious that it has immediate and retrospective effect. That the judgment, and Cat Dalrymple, keep me right, is we will apply beyond sexual offences cases.
Yeah, that's correct.
And it will be a matter for the Lord Advocate in terms of how she pursues prosecutions. So some of, you know, and I will, of course, have, you know, meetings and catch-up sessions with the Lord Advocate, and it will be for her to perhaps look at modelling to anticipate, you know, the impact that this would have on prosecutions. But it does have an immediate and retrospective.
Yeah. So I mean, there's potential impact for this to be significant in terms of volume of additional work, but we just don't know. It's too early to say.
It's too early to say, but it has potential to increase prosecutions.
Okay,
I think that's
thanks.
Fair to say.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay. I'm just going to ask if any other members would like to come in on courts at all. Pauline McNeill, I think you were indicating.
Yeah, it's just a question. It kind of relates to the SSI as well that we'll be dealing with later on. And it's simply this. The committee are going to be asked to vote for an SSI to extend the time limits in court proceedings. But I'll just ask you directly, the Cabinet Secretary, is one of the reasons we've been asked to do this because the Scottish Court Tribunal Service don't have the budget to actually get these time limits nearer to what the legal requirement is?
No, I think, although I do think this is about our ongoing recovery from the pandemic. I mean, we'll obviously discuss this in greater detail later. Originally, there were seven time limits, seven extensions to time limits with committee's approval. We'll remove some of those, you know, further to this hearing of committee, and we will have in place three out of the seven. So we are making progress, and we're making progress because the court backlog programme is making progress. That is, the backlog is down by a third since the start of last year, and we have, there's actually increasing resource has went into the solemn cases in terms of two additional high courts and six additional sheriff summary courts. So we're lifting the time limits because the test of when they were applied was whether it was necessary and proportionate, and we're lifting those time limits because it's no longer necessary and proportionate. The remaining ones, which we'll discuss later, is that we believe that those continue to be necessary.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before we move on to our final area around prisons, I wonder if I can just ask the Cabinet Secretary just about some of the evidence that Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service have given the committee. In their evidence, they've set out increased costs in terms of developing evidence by commissioner, a greater number of solemn cases being prosecuted, additional work that would be required as a result of the changes introduced by virtue of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill. And of course, another issue is around the increase in death reports and investigations. So I'm just wondering what priority the Cabinet Secretary is giving to those individual sort of areas of work and ensuring that the required resources are in place.
So just to point out, these issues are important, but the Lord Advocate negotiates her budget with the Deputy First Minister in the same way that all Scottish Government ministers do. So while the Justice Portfolio budget will have a direct bearing on, you know, police, fire and courts, it does not for the Crown Office. So, you know, I am limited in what I can say in and around that, because that's a discussion for the Lord Advocate with the Deputy First Minister. Obviously, in terms of the Victims, Witness and Justice Reform Bill, I'm not going to say too much because we have a number of lengthy sessions ahead of us. But that bill will hopefully reach stage three in advance of next year's budget. So in terms of, you know, some of the discussion we've had in and around the implementation of legislation, that will be a live issue for certainly next year's budget. And I will talk to committee more about my initial thoughts about how the implementation of what is a landmark bill, how that can be phased.
Thank you very much for that. Okay, we're going to move on to our final area for questions, prisons. And I wonder if I can maybe just kick things off before I bring other members in with a question around the prison population, which obviously we heard a little bit about this morning in our previous session. So I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary feels that the current prison population and remand prisoner levels are acceptable and sustainable, and does she have specific plans to address this? When will these be set out for Parliament to consider? And are there any budgetary implications for justice organisations arising from these?
So, notwithstanding that people are imprisoned on decisions made by the courts, I do think the current prison population is too high, and I don't think it's sustainable. When I went to my work 20 years ago, in HMP Perth, the prison population was 5,500. It's now this week 7,964. A high prison population, it comes with risks. Her Majesty Inspectorate of Prisons made that very clear. And she issued a clarion call for action. And it is one I intend to pursue, because at the end of the day, a high prison population doesn't just present risks for the well-being of prisoners and staff. It is not in the best interest of our communities in terms of reducing re-offending. When I met with justice spokespeople a few weeks ago, I made clear that the statement I made to Parliament in October would not be my first and only statement to Parliament, and I would certainly anticipate returning to Parliament before the end of the year. And there are indeed budgetary implications of a high prison population. Some of that is just operational costs for the Scottish Prison Service. And as I intimated earlier, there are smarter ways to invest money to keep our communities safe, notwithstanding that there will always be a need for prisons, and it will always be the case that prison is necessary, absolutely necessary for public protection.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in some other members now. I think we've got Pauline McNeill and then Russell Finlay. Pauline.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, I had an exchange with Teresa Medhurst and Jerry O'Donnell just about the plans for HMP Glasgow. I'm sure I don't need to rehearse the urgency that's required here and the pressure on the prison population and standards of prisons and so on. But when I tried to press them on the completion date, because there's been some press around this, and it's just unclear to the committee what the date is or the ambition for the date is. But what she did say, Teresa Medhurst did say, is that it will depend on the capital allocation. I'm not really sure what she meant by that, but I presume she meant in discussion with the Scottish Government of what capital allocation will be available, presumably in the year of build. It's really hard to follow this. I mean, so first of all, is the Scottish Government prepared to make the capital allocation when it's required for the build of HMP Glasgow?
So the replacement of HMP Berlinney, I can assure Ms McNeill committee, is indeed a priority. It is a priority that will have consequences for other actions that we wouldn't be able to pursue as quickly as we wanted within the prison estate. But I can assure you that a new facility to replace Berlinney is a priority. It will be a large infrastructure project that will require funding over a number of years, and it will require a sustained commitment. Mm-hmm. We won't know timescale until we know costs, and we won't know the costs until we get the final designs. So that's, you know, the bottom line, that there, you know, perhaps isn't as specific information as people would desire. We're all keen for that specific information, but we need to know the final design so we know the final anticipated cost, because costs of infrastructure projects change, as we know. So once we know cost, we can work out a timescale and we can work out the capital budget accordingly. But it will be, this isn't a one-year only investment.
Thank you. So does that mean that the anticipated date of 2026 is not a real date anymore, or is that just fluid?
Well, I'm not sure. So I know that there have been various dates produced and bandied about, but I think, you know, to be absolutely clear with committee, we want to get to the costs so we can get to implementation, and so we can make those plans in the capital budget so that there is an up-to-date timeline for everybody to work towards.
So we have been told that the design will be expected to complete April of next year. Mm-hmm. So not having any idea whatsoever about how you build such, I understand it's a big infrastructure project, but will you press the relevant people then to give an answer from April forward as to run some estimate about when a project like that can start? Am I right in thinking that if you have a design plan at that point, presumably you can then cost it?
Yes, I mean, I think that's the point I was making, that it's in my interests, and I am particularly motivated to see those final design plans as soon as possible, so that we can then have a more definitive view of cost, and then once we know costs, we can then plan accordingly. But I mean, it is an absolute priority.
So I'm taking it from what you're saying to committee that if it's a priority, if we see the design plans in April, then you'll start to release the relevant capital for that to be to get work started.
Yeah, I just didn't want you to be under the impression that this was a 1 year only capital.
Yes, I'm learning. But to be candid, it's not fair for the committee to be left with the perception by the government or the SPS that it's just like a moving thing all the time. And I know it's complicated, but I just feel up to this point, kind of, it's a bit smoke and mirrors to actually pin anything down at all for a project that's meant to be a priority. So that's all I'm trying to press on.
You know, I would not being a builder. I would share some of that frustration, but I know that the Scottish Prison Service and particularly the Governor at Barlinnie are very focused on this. We do have to accept that the pandemic and the construction materials price index, with a 47% increase overall in construction materials, that all of these things have an impact. But I want to have as much clarity as soon as possible. And I know that that's shared by the Scottish Prison Service as well.
Thank you.
Okay, I think Rona Mackay, you've got a very tiny supplementary, and then I'll bring in John Swinney.
Just to follow up Colleen McNeill's line. You just said yourself about the increasing building costs, which just go up astronomically year by year. And I don't know if there's any precedence for this, but is putting a cap on the final cost, would that ever be considered by you to say, well, you know, this is the maximum that we can go to, and the design needs to be brought into line with that? I mean, I don't know if that's ever been done. I just wondered if that would be a way to give more certainty to it.
So, I am conscious of other infrastructure projects, other public sector infrastructure projects that have been impacted by events, whether it's inflation, construction, labour shortages, Brexit, all the rest of it. And I think given the lengthy lead-in time for infrastructure projects, it is difficult to rule out the prospect of any event, interrupting plans. I mean, people start building infrastructure projects and they find something of historical or architectural, important. There are all sorts of things that can happen. But perhaps I can give you some assurance that the Scottish Government executive team are very interested and have had some discussions and opportunity to delve into the plans as they exist right now to ensure, because it's in the interest of all justice partners to ensure that those plans are as robust and indeed as realistic as possible.
Thank you.
John Swinney, then Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Kavira. When the Scottish Prison Service were with the committee this morning, their Director of Finance highlighted the fact that the backlog of construction projects post-COVID, coupled to the challenges around the supply chain on the replacement of infrastructure because of the impact of Brexit and the loss of free movement of individuals, and the wider effects of construction inflation, which you, Cabinet Secretary, have just said to the committee, totals a 47% increase in construction materials. Is it correct that these factors will be affecting not just the cost of renewing the prison infrastructure, but they will be affecting all other aspects of capital investment across the Scottish Government's capital programme?
Yes, that's true. And I've had a summer tour of visiting our prison establishments, which has meant that I've looked very closely at conditions, where we are with making improvements to the estate, as well as our ambitions around HMP Glasgow, HMP Highland. And yes, I now know that according to ONS, there's a 65% increase in the number of vacancies in construction, that the BEIS Construction Materials Price Index shows a 47% increase overall. There's an 82% increase in structural steel, 39% increase in precast concrete, 32% increase in gravel and sand. And all of that has an impact, not just on our ambitions and justice, but also across the government.
And has the United Kingdom government engaged with the Scottish government on any changes to expected financial support to take account of really quite a colossal and unprecedented set of damaging impacts on the sustainability of a long-term capital programme?
No, not that I'm aware of. Obviously, the Deputy First Minister and Finance Secretary will engage with the UK government. But as I said in answer to an earlier question, I mean, our position with our capital budget is extremely challenging. There'll be nearly a 4% real terms reduction for the next financial year. And between now and 27 and 28, there'll be nearly a 7% reduction. There will, of course, be an opportunity for Deputy First Minister to be laying out indicative long-term spends in accordance to the anticipated envelope for resource and capital. But it's just a matter of fact, as opposed to a political point, to be seen that the UK government has not inflation-proofed capital. That applies to Scotland. It also applies, you know, it'll apply to local authorities across the UK and the Welsh devolved government as well.
Thank you. If I could move on to one other aspect, if I have a moment, and that's in relation to the detail that you just placed on the record a moment ago, Cabinet Secretary, which I was very struck by from your experience in your professional life of the size of the prison population and where it is now. And if I was to make a rough calculation of the financial difference of the budgetary costs of accommodating that larger number of prisoners, I would estimate it must come in at about £90 million of a difference, or something of that order. Now, for that scale of additional financial pressure being managed by the Scottish budget, that would strike me as creating the conditions in which the Scottish Government, the judiciary, community justice services and other diversionary activity services should be absolutely focused on maximising the opportunities to avoid incarceration if it is safe for that option to be taken. Are all these players engaged in that dialogue, Cabinet Secretary? Are they all pointing in the same direction?
So, in my engagement with all justice partners, I am endeavouring to ensure that all the arrows are faced in the right direction.
With the greatest respect, that wasn't the question I was asking, Cabinet Secretary.
I think we are getting there. There is the Prison Population Leadership Group. What we need to avoid is people just seeing the prison service as the end of the line, that they've done their job. You know, they have prosecuted and the courts have done their job and, you know, people have been arrested. And, of course, these things need to continue to happen. But we must realise that a growing and unsustainable prison population isn't just a Scottish prison service population. It is a justice problem and ultimately it will be a community safety problem. So in terms of ensuring all the arrows are flying in the right direction, I'm confident that there is a growing realisation within the justice sector that our prisons aren't the end of the line. They, you know, these are practitioners. They will know that you know what happens in prisons matters, and it matters because most people will come out. But the point I would make is this isn't just a justice sector issue. It is not just a justice sector issue. So, you know, my engagement, for example, with health services is particularly important. And I'll just give one example. So, as the Scottish Prison Service reconfigures the use of their current prison estate, and there's limits to that, but they are renovating part of Pullman to use spare capacity there, But as the prison population increases in Poland, that will have an increasing pressure and demand on health services for Forth Valley, which is a smaller health board. So therefore, you know, this is an issue that I raise in the cross-ministerial group on justice and health. So that's just one example.
I appreciate that point, but is there also a wider understanding and engagement within government beyond the justice organisations about the necessity to ensure that some of the other solutions that could result in the reduction in the prison population, such as the availability of supported accommodation, employment and training opportunities, literacy and numeracy support, health and wellbeing support, mental health interventions, is that being recognised within government as of sufficient necessity to give us the prize of reducing the amount of money that we are spending on incarceration, which in the comparison that you gave to the committee is of a very, very substantial amount of public expenditure?
Yes, I believe there's a growing understanding and appreciation that this isn't just an SPS problem or indeed a justice problem. And I report on a weekly basis to Cabinet on the situation in and around our prisons. And part of the work that we are doing to address the situation, whether it's, you know, the immediacy of the situation, but also in the longer term, is that, you know, recalibration of what we need to do in justice, but we will also be having very specific asks of other colleagues across government.
Thank you, Kavir.
Thank you very much. Russell Finn.
Very, very quickly, I know I don't have much time, but these questions both relate directly to the evidence we heard earlier from the SPS. They have previously put a figure on HMP Glasgow, a potential figure of £400 million. They now seem reluctant to speculate until next year when the plans are complete. I just do wonder how they were able to come up with a figure prior to that. And I just wonder if the Scottish Government have got any indication as to how much this might come in at, a worst-case scenario or a best-case scenario.
So I'm not going to speculate because I just don't think that is helpful. I will say it will cost more than £400 million. I think I am confident of that. And as soon as we have clarity on the final design, we'll have clarity on costs, and I will endeavour to share that with committee because it is a matter of public interest.
And given the SPS's capital budget for the past 3 years has been less than £400 million in total, are you confident government will be able to pay for this and the SPS will be able to pay for this?
I've already indicated that the new HMP Glasgow is indeed a priority, and it's a high priority. There will, of course, have to be decisions made about the phasing of resources. This isn't a one year only investment or project. I don't think anybody is under any misapprehension that we are going to have to replace the somewhat Victorian HMP Barony.
The SPS also were unable to tell us how much it would cost to transfer HMP Kilmarnock and what their likely costs will be to run HMP Kilmarnock. Has Scottish Government done any financial analysis of this, and can that be shared with the committee?
Well, I would be expecting that information to come from SPS, and we'll pick that up with SPS.
But in 2019, when the government decided to bring Kilmarnock into public ownership, was a financial analysis done at that point, and can that be shared with the committee?
I will double check that. I wasn't Cabinet Secretary in 2019. I do know that as the contract comes to an end, that a decision has to be made. So when the contract comes to an end next year, you either bring HMP Kilmarnock back into public ownership, or you would have to go through a re-tendering exercise.
It'd be really interesting to know just what the financial considerations were at the time of that decision.
OK,
Okay, so thank you.
I will see what can be shared, convener. I do know that part of the financial consideration would be that the more recent private prison, Addiewell, is certainly more expensive than HMP Kilmarnock, and that's because it will be more reflective of more recent market conditions. So there will be, you know, some information that we can that share that I hope would be helpful.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you. That brings us up to time. So can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and our officials for joining us this morning, and we'll just take a short suspension before we move on to our next agenda item. Thank you. Okay, thank you, members. So our next four agenda items all relate to our consideration of two affirmative instruments, namely the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act 2022, extension and expiry of temporary justice measures, regulations of 2023, and the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment Order of 2023, number 2. So we will start with the extension and expiry of temporary justice measures, and I refer members to paper 3 and particularly to table 1 on page 12, which contains a helpful summary of what is proposed. And I would also refer members to paper 4, which contains a letter we received from the Cabinet Secretary earlier this week and sets out plans for a consultation on the permanency of certain criminal justice measures from the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act of 2022. So I'm pleased to welcome back the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs, Angela Constance, and her officials to the meeting. So Ms Susan Black, Senior Policy Officer, Civil Law and Legal System. Ms Emma Thompson, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Ms Heather Tully, Justice Reform Unit. Mr Patrick Down, Criminal Law Practice and Licensing Unit. Ms Nicola Guild, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. And so I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to the instrument.
Thank you very much, Convener. As committee knows, the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act 2022 includes a range of temporary justice measures that are due to expire at the end of this month. The measures were introduced to make sure our justice system had the tools it needed to respond to the pandemic's impact. Justice agencies have made significant progress towards recovery, and the need for some of these measures has reduced. Therefore, the regulations before the committee this morning expire those measures that I believe are no longer necessary or proportionate. That includes four of the time limit extension provisions that were put in place at the start of the pandemic. The regulations modify the expiry date in section 52(1) of the 2022 Act so that the remaining provisions, which I believe are still needed, stay in force until the 30th of November 2024. To inform decisions on which measures to extend, we reviewed the operation of the provisions and consulted stakeholders. We engaged with justice agencies to understand the effect each provision is having and the likely impact if it were not extended. We also sought views from the legal profession, judiciary, victims organisations and from third sector organisations. And the findings of our review and consultation are set out in the statement of reasons it laid alongside the regulations. For now, I will briefly highlight three key reasons that mean we need to retain those provisions that the regulations extend. Firstly, we are seeing the impact of the pandemic on criminal court backlogs. We're still seeing the impact of the pandemic on those backlogs. Although substantial progress has been made, the backlog has fallen by around 15,700 since January 2022. However, the committee will know that the modelling of the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service predicts that solemn backlogs will remain above pre-pandemic levels until 2026. The temporary measures we wish to extend have an important role to play in ensuring that court resources are used efficiently. Without them, this timescale would be longer. There would also be a serious risk that some cases could not proceed at all. This is particularly important for the extension of the statutory time limits for certain criminal proceedings. The regulations seek to retain 3 out of the 7 extended time limits. These extended time limits increase the court's capacity to hear trials rather than procedural matters, which helps the throughput of cases and protects victims' access to justice. And as the statement of reasons explains, without the extended time limit for the prosecution of certain summary-only offences, many prosecutions for drink and drug driving offences could be abandoned because those time limits cannot be extended on a case-by-case basis. We all want to see a return to pre-pandemic time limits as soon as possible, but none of us want to jeopardise the throughput of trials or put prosecutions at risk. And it is clear to me that the three remaining extended time limits need to be continued at this stage, and we will, of course, keep them under review. The second key consideration is protecting health. The Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Act, passed by the Parliament in June, includes a permanent power allowing for the early release of some prisoners in certain emergency situations. However, that power is not yet in force. The temporary provisions on emergency early release of prisoners, therefore, remain an important safeguard to make sure we can act to protect the lives of those living and working in prisons in response to a threat from COVID. While I, of course, hope that the likelihood of such a threat arising remains low, the harm caused by not having the measures available, it could be severe. And finally, convener, our review highlighted that there is support for making some of the temporary measures permanent. That is beyond the scope of these regulations, but this week we launched a public consultation that proposes making permanent those temporary measures that I believe can deliver significant longer-term benefits and help to make our justice system more resilient, efficient and effective. Whereas the regulations are binary, we can either extend or expire provisions. We cannot modify them. The consultation offers us opportunity to hear views on how we might adapt and improve provisions so they deliver even better outcomes and experiences for the people using them. In the meantime, I believe the package of measures extended by the regulations is critical to help support our justice system's continued recovery and resilience in the coming year. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
OK, thank you very much for that helpful statement. So I'm going to bring in any members now who would want to ask any questions at all. So I've got Fulton MacGregor, Pauline McNeill, and then Russell Finlay. So Fulton, first of all.
Thanks, convener. And it's just really a quick question on part three, the failure to appear before court following police liberation. And this enabled the court to modify the date someone is required to attend court on an undertaking if they fail to appear for a reason attributable to coronavirus. I'm assuming that's if they're unwell with the virus. The proposal is for this to expire on the 29th of this month. Just wondering what the thinking behind that was, Cabinet Secretary, because I know that obviously coronavirus is still amongst us. Thanks.
It's already expired.
Yes, it's been expired by the regulations, Mr MacGregor, because it's no longer proportionate or necessary or required because of the progress that has been made overall in the functioning of our justice system. So that will expire from the end of the 29th and of this month. And again, it is something that we've consulted carefully on, and in particular from all our justice partners, and there is support for allowing that part of the coronavirus legislation to expire.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. First of all, I just want to understand, make sure I've understood what is we've been asked to do here. So, in the debate on the extension of time limits due to coronavirus, the government set out its position. I think you also said that there may be a requirement to do this in 2026. So does that mean for each year you want to extend them, you have to come to committee with an SSI? Which is, this is the procedure I'm trying to understand.
So in terms of the three remaining time limits, and there's only three out of the seven original time limits that we propose continue, that the government can keep those under review. and you know, so they can only be expired, they can only be extended on a year-by-year basis, so they can be extended till next year, and thereafter they could only be subject to one further extension. And any permanent changes to those time limits would require primary legislation, and we don't have any plans to introduce any primary legislation in relation to time limits. We want to get to the place where we're back to the pre-pandemic normal.
Thank you. I understand. So you weren't Cabinet Secretary at the time, but on the floor, I was particularly exercised, as I have been for some time, about the extension of time limits. And the first point to make is that, for some reason, Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service were in excess of the 1985 Act for several months of out with the required time before the coronavirus. We never really got to the bottom of why that was allowed to happen in the first place. And it's why I've got severe reservations about just allowing further extensions, albeit I accept there's progress being made. But one particular debate I want to highlight and ask you about. So I can at least understand where the government are coming from in relation to solemn proceedings by extending the time limit in relation to first appearance and so on, and the preliminary trial and the trial itself. What I've never had an explanation for is the indictment. Now, the Crown have got 80 days, and under this they'll have, is it up 320 days? Why on earth? I suppose I need to press Cabinet Secretary on this. If you haven't done it, will you do it? The Crown should be pressed to the nth degree on why they need 320 days to prepare a case. I mean, they've had, compared to other justice services, they've had a better settlement over the years in relation to pay, which I know there's still a significant shortfall. So why on earth can they justify asking for these extensions? I'm at a loss to understand that, if you see what I mean. So the preparation of the detail of an accusation in court, following the indictment, it just leads you to very suspicious as to why. I mean, the Crown have always complained that 80 days is too tight, but we've always said, as a country, that we are actually proud of the tight time limits that we've had. And I know you might remember the discussion, you know, the debate we've had through the years. But I need to press you on that. Why does the Crown need an extension to 360 days to 2026 to prepare cases?
So I'll answer what I think is within my remit to answer. First and foremost, at the earliest opportunity, I don't want us to have any of these coronavirus time limit regulations in place any longer than they need to be. I want to get back to what our original legislation and the standards set out in that. I'm also aware that, and this goes back to my experience in the prison system, although that wasn't yesterday, I'm also aware that time limits could always be altered on a case-by-case basis. And that isn't, I don't have any statistics at hand in and around that, but that is far from uncommon. And one of the reasons for us wanting to continue with the three time limits is what I want to avoid is the misuse of precious court resources that should be focused on the backlog, should be focused on getting through trials, as opposed to clogging up the system with procedural hearings. So in terms of your reflection on increasing investment into the Crown Office, I think there's a matter of public record. I think in the last 5 years, their budget has went up 50 to 75%, notwithstanding that the demands on their workload has most certainly increased for the reasons outlined in our earlier evidence session. So you know, in terms of being helpful, I don't know whether committee would wish for me to ask the Lord Advocate to, you know, reply to Ms McNeill or to write to the committee, or whether committee would wish to do that. But I've endeavoured to answer your question as best I can in terms of my position.
Yeah, I understand you can't answer that question because you're not. I suppose what I'm really saying is I'd like to think that the government are pressing the Crown for an answer, because you're coming to the committee asking us to endorse this, and I don't think there's any justification for the Crown asking for. I'm less sympathetic to that one, is what I really mean. But yeah, can I ask you about the letter? I've only just seen it. So I understand you're consulting on permanent measures that would include signing of electronic documents, enabling virtual attendance at criminal court, national jurisdiction for calling for custody. So, and that's that list of things you're asking for to be permanent. We'll not be able to cover this today, but can I highlight a few areas of concern I've got about this? Have you discussed with the legal profession, for example, national jurisdiction? That must have huge implications for where you try people and where the lawyers have to be.
Yes, and actually there is a very helpful quote that I read that came from a High Court judge, in that the advantage of having a national jurisdiction for calling from custody cases is that where there are a number of warrants, indictments from various courts across the country, that they can be heard at the one place. I am also an advocate for not, where possible, busing prisoners around the country. I don't think it's efficient or
but if effective. You get this power, that's what will happen. If you get this power and there's national jurisdiction, that's exactly what will happen. They'll just try cases in courts wherever they can, presumably.
So, but yeah, it will mean that you can try someone in any court, which would mean it could be a more local court, as opposed to, you know, transporting somebody from a prison at one end of the country to a court at the other. My view is that this is just common sense, but nonetheless, it's a consultation, and people will have their, you know, opportunity to respond to that consultation. The government will have to reflect on the consultation, mm-hmm. and then there would have to be the normal legislative process. So I hope I can give some reassurance that there'll be
Just lastly, a point of clarification about virtual attendance at criminal courts. I've expressed my concern about what I've seen so far. The quality is not good enough to justify that being a replacement for physical attendance. Does that apply to custody courts? The reason I ask is I thought the government had supported my amendment in relation to not having custody courts. You don't have to answer that today. It's just I'm confused by this.
I did hear you raise this, Ms McNeill, in earlier committee sessions. And my understanding, and I'm happy to write to you offline, but my understanding is that you had lodged amendments at stage 2 and stage 3, but then didn't move them. And that was in relation to an exchange that you had with Mr Brown. But I'm happy to supply the information that I've been privy to on that.
I don't think it's accurate. Just for completeness, okay. For the record, there was one amendment that was accepted by the government, and I understood it meant, based on the quality of the experience of custody courts going into 10 o'clock at night in Glasgow anyway, I don't know other, and to huge cost to the public purse, because the quality of the connection was so bad. And actually, they were calling, I actually saw it for myself, the mistakes that were being made, and for that reason I thought at least there was a ban on virtual appearance for custody courts for that reason. But anyway, I would be grateful if I could get some clarification around that, because it's for that reason I would have to raise my concerns about continuation of virtual appearances.
So just perhaps for clarity in relation to these regulation, for most criminal business, the default position is that people attend hearings physically, but the provisions give the Lord Justice General a power to issue determinations to change the default to virtual attendance for certain types of cases or in certain types of circumstances. So I suppose virtual appearance is not something new. It's obviously there's been a further developments and further scope and further use of the existing legislative opportunities or the existing powers of the Lord Justice General in terms of the pandemic, and the question in terms of the consultation and what the consultation will consult on is electronic signage and the sending of electronic documents, the virtual attendance at a criminal court, and the national jurisdiction of calling from custody, and the maximum level of fiscal fines. So that's what the consultation relates to.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Katie Clark, I'm not sure if you're wanting to ask about the consultation letter.
Yes.
I'd quite like to keep our questions focused on the motion, and I'm very happy for us to write to the Cabinet Secretary with any questions on the consultation letter, but I'd be quite keen to pull things back.
It's to do with the language that's used.
If your question's about the motion, then
that would be helpful. It's to do with the national jurisdictions from calling from custody, and the Cabinet Secretary made a specific mention to trials. So just to be absolutely clear, you're not talking just about the initial appearance from custody. This relates to all aspects of the criminal process. Pauline McNeill's already referred to agents, so presumably that would mean witnesses also would have to go to a different part of the country to give evidence if it's all aspects of the criminal process. If we could have clarification in terms of the term calling, what that means, what that word means.
That's a good point. I'll ask officials to answer that.
So in terms of the provisions in the regulations, this is about callings from custody. So it is specific to custody cases and those first callings, rather than it being something that's available for trials generally.
Yes, so it's just the initial, it's not all every diet, it's just the initial appearance from custody. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And Russell Finlay, I'll bring you in.
Thanks very much, Convener. I've got a couple of questions in relation to part two and fiscal fines. Now, these, of course, allow the Crown Office to be are issued by the Crown Office in response to certain offences, and the threshold has been raised from £300 to £500. But this legislation also extends their use to what's described as a wider range of crimes. I just wonder if you can tell crime victims exactly what crimes this now encompasses.
So I appreciate, Convener, that some people for ideological reasons may be opposed to fiscal fines as an alternative to prosecution. And of course, all prosecution matters are not for me, they're for the independent Crown Office, and for good reason. We should not be having politicians preside over matters of prosecution. What the regulations are about are not so much the fundamental existence of fiscal fines, but is around increasing the scope of the fine from 300 to 500. It could potentially, again, a matter for independent prosecutors, it could reduce the number of cases going to the Justice of the Peace Court if the prosecutor decides to offer a fine.
The question was what crimes it now encompasses, what's it been extended to?
Well, it's fiscal fines have existed for many decades for less serious crimes. And as I have indicated, that they are likely to be crimes that could perhaps be dealt with by the Justice of the Peace Court. Sure. But there are limits on the type and the nature of offences that would be subject to fiscal fines. They're not for any offence. But maybe officials could give you some further reassurance.
I believe that COPFS have previously written to the committee setting out that it's not possible to set out a definitive list of offences fiscal fines could be used for. However, that legally there are not any offences which can now receive a fiscal fine which could not also have received a fiscal fine before the 2020 legislation introduced this new higher maximum. So the measures and the regulations do not change the offences which can attract a fiscal fine.
Well, that does seem slightly at odds with the information we have in these documents, which says it is now being applied to a wider range of offences. But I'll move on, because it's clear that people aren't being told what offences that they will be applied to.
Lord Advocate.
Perhaps. And in response to the point you made about people's ideological opposition, I don't think crime victims are ideologically opposed to them. I think they want to see justice being done and they want transparency. And one of the concerns many of them express is that with these direct measures, there's little or no explanation given to them as victims. They also make the point that the Crown Office rightly deals with prosecutorial matters. But here we are as parliamentarians discussing what those should be. So it's not a question of it being entirely up to them. Going back to the point about the extension of their use and the increase of their value from £300 to £500, is there not an argument to be made that if the government wants this to be part of the legislative framework for the criminal justice system, it should be brought forward as standalone legislation rather than brought in by stealth using the COVID pandemic legislation?
So, fiscal fines have existed since the 1990s. Mm-hmm. These regulations are talking about, as we've heard from officials, are talking about continuing the increase in the fines from £300 to £500. In terms of standalone legislation, the letter to committee that I sent earlier this week already advises that it will be a matter of public consultation in terms of the coronavirus regulations that we believe would improve the efficiency and resilience of the justice sector, and that there will be a public consultation on our proposition to make some of those permanent, and depending on the outcome of that public consultation, that indeed would require legislation.
But it's a public consultation on details that we don't know what they are. We don't know what the criteria are for the increased scope of these.
Well, I mean, just to be clear, convener, while I'm aware that Mr. Finlay and not victims may have ideological objections to fiscal fines as an alternative to prosecution.
I just have to pick up on that. I'm sorry, I don't have ideological opposition to fiscal fines. I think there should be a lot more transparency around their use, and I mean, don't see why there's opposition
to that.
Bearing in
mind, the Crown Office write to committee regularly, and I indeed have also written to Mr. Finlay on this matter. As well, again, you know, supplying a great deal of information, notwithstanding the importance of separation of powers, which are important to the very fabric of justice and our democracy.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So I'm now going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion number 10547, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Act of 2022 extension and expiry of temporary justice measures regulations 2023 be approved.
Moved, convener.
Thank you very much. So the question is that motion number 10547 in the name of Angela Constance be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed, so there will be a division. So can I ask all of those in favour of the motion to please raise your hands? Okay, thank you. All of those opposed to the motion, raise your hands. Okay, thank you very much. There are no abstentions. So we have... So we have four votes in favour of the motion, four votes against the motion. So in view of that, I will use my casting vote and agree to the motion. Therefore, the motion is agreed. So thank you very much. And can I also have members' approval for the clerks and I to publish a short factual report on both of our SSIs today? I know we're going to continue on to the second one. Thank you very much. OK, thank you. So with that, I'm going to now invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak to the second instrument.
Yes, thank you, convener. The draft, the International Organisations Immunities and Privilege Scotland Amendment No. 2, Order 2023, is an order in council made by His Majesty under powers in the International Organisations Act 1968. The nature of the reserved devolved divide means that where privileges and immunities relate to devolved matters in Scotland, the function of advising His Majesty in relation to the order is devolved. A parallel order has been made as and is in force in the rest of the UK and for non-devolved Scots law. This order confers no new privileges and immunities, but simply expands the range of meetings where they apply, in line with the 1959 Agreement on the Privileges and Immunities of the International Atomic Energy Agency, the IAEA. In order to assist the committee, I will say a little more about the background to this order. In the 1959 agreement, the UK agreed to provide privileges and immunities to representatives of agency members attending any international conference, symposium, seminar or panel covered by the agency. This language was not entirely reflected in the subsequent 1974 Immunities and Privileges Order, which implemented the agreement obligations into UK domestic law. The discrepancy recently came to light during the development of the host country agreement requirement to hold the 2023 IAEA Fusion for Energy Conference in London. As it is at odds with the agreement obligation, it was agreed with the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office that this should be remedied by each administration to the extent that they have power to do so. Separately, this order makes consequential amendments resulting from the parallel UK order, that is to restate the provisions of the 1974 order that are within the legislative competence of the Scottish Parliament and is an opportunity to clarify the definition of representatives of members so that it more fully reflects the wording of the 1959 agreement. So passing this order will correct a historic error and ensure that we are able to fully meet our international obligations. As a good global citizen, it is the responsibility of the Scottish Government to bring the order to the Parliament for consideration, and I commend it to the committee.
Okay, thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. So we'll now move to questions. And can I ask any members if they have any questions or comments? No, nothing at all. Okay, thank you. So can I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move motion number 10537, that the Criminal Justice Committee recommends that the International Organisations Immunities and Privileges Scotland Amendment No. 2 Order of 2023 be approved.
Moved.
Thank you. So the question is that motion number 10537 in the name of Angela Constance be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. So thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary and officials, for your time this morning. And that concludes the public part of our meeting. Next week, we will see the Cabinet Secretary again to take evidence on parts 1 to 3 of the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill. And we'll be looking also at the HMICS report on policing and mental health in Scotland. So thank you. And we now move into private session. Thank you.